In this series, Roadmap to Success, we are pleased to have with us today Mr. Dev Bhattacharya, Group President, Aditya Birla Group, responsible for developing strategies, looking at mergers and acquisitions in a number of sectors, power, BPO 90, solar power, e-commerce, payments bank, and lately he has been very actively engaged in terms of developing strategy for the agriculture sector. Government is very much interested in investing in the agriculture sector and looking at modernizing the agriculture sector. Yeah. So in that context, when the Government of India is planning to double the farmer income by 2022, I would like to start by asking you, Mr. Bhattacharya, do you think this is going to inspire the youth of the country?
I think, you know, in every other sector, when you say that there is a greater allocation of amount or money or outlay, it generally leads to greater capital formation, it leads to greater income, it leads to more jobs, etc. In the agriculture sector, the problem is the youth who are urban-oriented probably do not know how do they connect to the economy that is getting so much of an allocation, what role can they play, how do they sort of cross that huge divide between what their current place of work or study is and how do they get to something like the rural economy and find a role for themselves. So I think while the government's focus is well-founded and the reason is that the gross value added has actually been dropping since the last few years. And so there is a 60% population who is now contributing to 15% of GDP. So there is a mismatch. And there are many reasons why. But the most important thing is that the land is not as productive as the factory floor space. And that is the main reason why a lot of people are engaged in something that doesn't produce as much value. Resultantly, 60% of the farmers in India have probably less than 1 hectare of land. And it's not surprising that, you know, the average income of a farmer is much lower than the average income of an industrial worker. Now, coming to, does it excite the youth of the country to look at opportunities in the agriculture sector? The first point that I'll make is that the agriculture sector as it exists today is very, very human oriented. There is very little mechanization, there is very little automation, there is very little sophistication of use of technology. Technology both in terms of hard technology as well as software technologies. And there is a very low level of migration from urban to rural as opposed to rural to urban, which we have seen through the last 5 decades. And therefore, the reason that people are not moving is that the transformation in the global economy is not showing up in Indian agriculture. It is showing up in many other agricultural economies, but not in India. And therefore, the question is, why not? And what is it that can be done? And therefore, what is the opportunity that the youth can look forward to? And the farmers find it fascinating that they can find out what they actually planted and cropped and harvested 10 years ago is actually available through satellite information. It's a fascinating information for people to get. And what can the weather pattern possibly be in the next 2-3 years as a result of which, what is it that they should ideally be growing in their land? So this is a very interesting sort of take on what technology can do. This is where I think youngsters can focus on a lot of opportunity of how technology and agriculture.
What would be the, let's say, the top 5 asks from agriculture education, which could be considered by the policy planners in due course?
So there is that disconnect. Like every other education is somewhat divorced from the practical side of the world. it applies in agriculture as well. But having said that, I think there is a lot of high quality skill and capability in the universities, agricultural universities in India. There are many of them, very high quality people, and I've dealt with many, and I think they are also seeking an opportunity to create a greater connect with, for them, industry, which is agriculture. There are lots of programs in the government, but I think what is more important is that given the higher allocation that the government is trying to do in agriculture, it is important that some of this allocation is used for upgrading the skills and capabilities of the teaching staff, and they're allowed to and help to go and travel overseas, go to other universities like universities in Israel or Holland or other parts of Asia as well, and go and see for themselves what is the change that is happening in those countries, and see whether there is something that we can replicate and create inter-country, international sort of exchange programs where students can travel, teachers can travel, experts can travel, and such a program is actually there between India and a few countries, but they need to be activated a little more, right? The program between India and Israel or India and Holland, I think it needs a little more funding, a little more backing, a little more support, so that there are actual experiments and long-term work done in agriculture. And as you know, in agriculture,
in the coming days, we are going to be seeing more and more technology infusion. You also spoke about that a little while ago. So would you agree that subjects like IoT, subjects like analytics, use of artificial intelligence, these should get integrated with the domain knowledge or domain education that we are imparting in agriculture, so that when these agriculture specialists come out of the universities, they are all-rounded and are able to utilize this these technology inputs in terms of how they would be able to look at problem solving in the real life scenarios?
Just the simple use of digital technology, which we are, you know, everybody knows how to do WhatsApp and Facebook. But do people know how to use an app to input data? For instance, we give them a application to input their data pertaining to what they are, what nutrients they're feeding into their land, what is the fertilizer that they're putting, what is the pesticide that they're spraying, what is the condition of the seed, the sapling, and the plant, and how do you input this data? What does this input data, inputting the data mean? How do you get output? How do you read it? What do you analyze, and how do you take action on what you get? This is the biggest learning that we want to give them in terms of technology input. If we get there, I think a lot of things will fall in place, because in agriculture, the issue is, it's not that technology companies are not concerned or not aware or not coming to the agriculture sector, but they're not able to communicate. They're not able to create a bridge. They're not able to create a two-way sort of movement of data and information between themselves and the farming community. Once you can do some movement in both ways, then there will be a transformation which will be massive.
Now, land is becoming a major issue, meaning in the coming days, we are going to see more and more of a pressure in terms of the availability of land for cultivation. Therefore, people are nowadays looking at vertical farming. This will require a complete mindset change and, of course, huge investment. Would you think that this could be one such example of how we should be exposing our youth to such concepts and doing some experiments and then learning from those experiments to see how modernization could be brought about?
Yeah, so you know, that's what I'm saying. When the youngsters come into rural India, and I have seen personally several hundreds of them, multi-level farming, for instance, is definitely a solution for India, or multi-cropping, or how do you rotate crops and how do you rejuvenate your soil where you actually continue to get your produce. So these are things that actually it's all available on YouTube. Surprisingly, it's available on YouTube. Somebody has to go through the information, sit through the information, go sit with the university professor and check with him, does this make sense? And you know, you can develop your own model of what you're going to try. And a lot of people are trying this multi-level farming. They're trying this you know, multi-cropping and several other things. So people are getting into nursery, people are getting into you know, Jeevamrit and all that, you know, natural farming. And there seems to be an opportunity to make these commercially viable very quickly. And it works. So productivity is a very important issue. For instance, Israel, if you compare India and Israel in terms of productivity, India is about 15% on an average. So you have an opportunity to go 8 times or 7 times. So look at where you can go if you can bring in the concepts of technology and automation into agriculture and farming. So, you know, the pathway is, you know, something that needs to be opened up. The opportunities and the support systems are all waiting in the wings for us to go and reach out to them.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bhattacharya. It's been a very interesting conversation, and the key takeaway for the youths, for the academic institutions, and for all of us is that agriculture is an exciting sector, and there are going to be opportunities not only for employment but for creating a range of entrepreneurial opportunities. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you very much.